Good morning, students. So I hope all of you are fine, safe. Last time we have discussed ectopic pregnancy, but only we could finish the dual ectopic pregnancy. The remaining parts we will going to finish it off today. So it is very rare. Dual ectopic is almost 95%, but the other rare types of ectopics we will discuss today. So the other one is ovarian. Even if it is rare, it is nowadays all other ectopics rather than tubal ectopics are increasing. So almost the incidence is around 1 in 40,000. So what are the main risk factors? So all other risk factors for tubal are same for ovarian ectopic also. The other one which is increased, endometriosis, which occurs on the surface of the ovary, which includes on the surface of the ovary. And this is the main important risk factor for ovarian ectopic. So course is as same as tubal ectopics usually, but it doesn't go more than 3 to 4 weeks. It gets ruptured around 3 to 4 weeks. Here, that is most important thing is you have to differentiate this from either the ruptured corpus luteum cyst and by unruptured tubal pregnancies. So how you will rupture? It is how you will differentiate these two. So mainly by this criteria diagnosis is they are saying it can be on the laparotomy or laparoscopy when we open. But nowadays, by an ultrasound, we can diagnose this. And the Spitzenberg criteria for diagnosis of ovarian ectopic are the tube on the side of the ectopic is intact. And it is separate from the sac. So you can very well see the tube separately from the sac. The sac occupies the portion of the ovary. Then the gestational sac is connected to the uterus by ovarian ligament. And sometimes it missed for the diagnosis. And when you do laparotomy or laparoscopy and do sacrophorectomy, on the histopathological examination, you can find the ovarian tissue in the wall of the ectopic sac. So if it is a ruptured one, you have to definitely go for laparotomy. And nowadays we are with the conservative surgeries. So oophorectomy can be done. But if you cannot, there is uncontrolled hemorrhage, you have to go for oophorectomy. If it is here it is mentioned that if it is unruptured, you can go for ovarian wedge resection and cystectomy if it is unruptured. But usually this is diagnosed only after rupture of the ectopic pregnancy. Girish? Next one, it is not coming. Girish? So the next one we are going to discuss is the abdominal pregnancy. Abdominal pregnancy in itself, it is very rare and usually it is always secondary to the tubal ectopic. Usually it is secondary where it is in after early tubal rupture or abortion. The fertilized ovum implants on the peritoneum and it continues to grow there. So definition of abdominal pregnancy is when it is early tubal rupture or abortion and the fertilized ovum gets implanted on the peritoneum and it continues to grow there. Primary abdominal pregnancy is extremely rare. So usually these patients will come with history of irregular bleeding, spotting, the signs and symptoms of normal pregnancy like nausea, vomiting, flatulence, constipation, diarrhea, abdominal pain. And the important here because is the patient will feel the pain every time the baby moves. And that is it is not that the fetal movements are painful. But in case of abdominal pregnancy, because it is sensitive, this one, the fetus is lying outside the uterus. Uterus is separate, the fetus is growing inside the abdominal cavity. So every time the fetal moves, the patient will have excruciating pain while the baby movements. And these are only felt in the upper abdomen side of them. the fetus grows in peritoneal cavity, here what will be the consequences? Even if the when there is a secondary abdominal pregnancy, here the fetal salvage is very rare and majority of the fetus dies. Female in this very uncomfortable nausea, abdominal pain, wherever the baby moves, already we have discussed. The most important thing is when we do abdominal examination, there will be abnormal fetal position. There will be abnormal contour of the fetal maternal abdomen. You can very well see there are two bulges where the uterus is separate and something irregular things can be seen and observed. And we can very well easily observe the fetal movements. So easily and on palpation, we can very well easily felt the fetal parts. Uterus is felt separately from the fetal movements. And more important thing is there will be no Braxtonic contraction. Sometimes when you do abdominal palpation, we can feel that uterus is getting hardening. But we cannot feel the Braxtonic contraction in abdominal pregnancy. And if we are misdiagnosed and if we do induction of labor, concluding that this is an intrauterine pregnancy, there will not be any uterine contractions if we give oxytocin infusion. So how you will diagnose? Nowadays, it is not to diagnose, it is by ultrasonography. And it can be diagnosed by, if it is confusing, we can diagnose by CT and MRI. It can be used. We can hear that this is also one condition where we can use the x-rays. And there are very few indications in obstetric where we want to use the x-rays. So here we can use x-ray for a diagnosis if there is any confusion. So these are the types, primary and secondary. These are the Studiford's criteria for diagnosis of primary abdominal pregnancy. So what are the Studiford criteria? The tubes and ovary should be normal. There should be absence of uteroperitoneal fistula. And the pregnancy is usually related to the peritoneal surface and young enough to rule out the possibility of secondary implantation. In secondary, already we have discussed that it is always due to the tubal abortion or tubal rupture, where the conceptive escapes out through the rent from the primary side. It can be intraperitoneal, it can be extraperitoneal, it can be into the broad ligament. So what is the fate of secondary abdominal pregnancy? I've already told you, because the placenta is held on the organs, vital organs, and there is no proper blood supply. So inevitably there is less salvage of the fetus. So death of the ovum, and it after death of the ovum, it can get completely reabsorbed. Complete absorption will be there. There can be other things to be very important here. We have to that because the placenta gets implanted onto the vital organ, sometimes on the major blood vessels, there can be placental separation and the patient can come to you with massive intraperitoneal hemorrhage and shock, a shock condition. So there can be infection, the fistulous communication with intestine, bladder, vagina can happen. The fetus dies and there can be mummification or adipose formation and classified into or calcified into the lithopedia. Rarely, very rarely, this pregnancy continues till term. There are very, very, very few cases which have been noted where the pregnancy has reached to term. So management is, because this is a very, the diagnosis is very confusing. It is always very diagnose-led. So as soon as possible the diagnosis is done, there is, you have to do urgent laparotomy, whatever is the period of gestation. So it is salvageable, non-salvageable, that doesn't matter. So whatever is the period of gestation, you have to go for urgent laparotomy. So before going for the laparotomy, that's what is more important is there should be at least 4 pints of packed cell volumes, red blood cell, this one should be kept ready. Because there will be torrential hemorrhage when we are trying to remove the placenta. So urgent laparotomy is required. It is ideal to remove the entire sac, fetus as far as possible without damaging the internal organs, placenta and membrane. If in case we are not able to remove the placenta completely, it is rather than doing harm to the patient, it is always better to leave the placenta there for the autolysis. And when we have removed, so here, what should we do? So when it is the placenta is left attached to vital organs, it will guess by aseptic autolysis. But we should always keep an eye. The patient should be always under observation in the hospital for the signs of infection, hemorrhage, because there can be, we have left the placenta. Here that we can do monitor the fetus with serial ultrasounds and beta HCG levels, whether they are decreasing, they are increasing, or they are plotting. We can give, when we have left, there some school of thought is there, we can give methotrexate injection intramuscularly where we have kept the placenta there. Very rarely laparoscopy, but laparotomy is the only mode of treatment for this. The other one is interligamentous, which is usually secondary for the tubal rupture. So next we go for cervical pregnancy. So what is the cervical pregnancy? When the implantation occurs in the cervical canal at or below the level of the internodulus, it is very important. The implantation should be, here you can see the implant, the sag is in the cervical canal. Can you see? Yeah, this is a yolk sac. This is a sac which is seen in the cervical canal. So implantation is there into the cervical canal. It is below the level of internal os. The incidence is, it is very rare. The incidence is around 1 in 18,000. All these other ectopic pregnancies, tubal ectopic, are increasing rates because of this increased use of ARTs. So it is rare, accounting for less than 1%. What are the risk factors? So risk factors, it is when we do previous induced abortions like DNCs, previous cesarean deliveries, because there is a scar is there, the endometrium, when we do DNC, when we are not very careful, when we are doing, can we do excessive scratching, there can be damage to the, and this can lead to Asherman syndrome. Procedures like IVFs, then DES exposure and leiomyoma. This is very rare, but the main important thing is previous DNCs and cesarean deliveries when there are scars are present. So this can form a nidus for sensation of lodging of the fetus. So usually it is diagnosed during when we do first trimester abortions and there is a torrential bleeding. Sometimes it can be that we can face with this calamity. So intact gestational sac, it has to be differentiated. Main important thing is this cervical pregnancy has to be differentiated with the inevitable abortion, where the gestational sac is passing through the cervix in cases of inevitable abortion. So what, how we will, it is always that when there is an inevitable abortion is there, the patient is in the process of abortion, there will, it will be extremely painful. But the cervical pregnancy, when it is lodged, it is usually painless. So this is the most important thing we have to. Do. So what there are the same criteria are there for diagnosis of cervical pregnancy. So here these are previously they used to say that it is a Rubin's criteria they used to follow, but nowadays we can do an ultrasound, we can diagnose it. What are the Rubin's criteria? Rubin's criteria is the presence of cervical glands opposite to the placental attachment. Attachment of placenta to the cervix should be below the entrance of the uterine vessels or below the peritoneal reflection, uterovesical fold of peritoneum. And the fetal element should not be present into the uterine cavity. But nowadays we can diagnose on ultrasonography. So what are these diagnostic criteria? On ultrasound, when we do torus vaginal ultrasound, there is the first thing is the uterine cavity is empty. There is no gestational sac into the uterine cavity. The cervix is usually enlarged. Typical, it is mentioned that it is a barrel-shaped cervix is there. Then because the cervix is enlarged, the uterus is normal size. The shape is appears like a hourglass uterus, ballooned out cervical canal. We can see the gestational sac below the level of the internal os. And the most important here is when you put the Doppler, the vascularity is there. So blood flow is seen around the gestational sac, which is very close to the internal os. So on ultrasound, there is one more thing to diagnose is sliding sign. This is the most important thing when we are used with whether it is a ongoing loss of the intrauterine pregnancy or it is a cervical pregnancy. So what is this sliding sign? The sliding sign helps to differentiate cervical pregnancy from miscarriages within the cervical canal. When on our doing ultrasound, when we applied the pressure to the cervix using the probe, in a miscarriage, the gestational sac slides against the cervical canal. It will slide along with the probe. But in cases of cervical pregnancy, the gestational sac doesn't slide along with the cervical or along with the probe, movement of the probe. So it is always constant, and this is a cervical ectopic. So what will be the management? Previously, the management used to be hysterectomy, but now we are more and more with conservative management. Here they have mentioned with BNC, but because this is a retrospective, when we are doing MTP for any other thing and when we land into the torrential bleeding, that is the thing. But the main important treatment for this previously used to be hysterectomy. They have mentioned the cerclage, but it is not that. But nowadays we are following more of a medical treatment. It is recently proposed either a single dose or combination multi-dose methotrexate, single dose methotrexate intramuscularly 50 milligram or multi-dose along with leucovarin. And the other things which can be used is actinomycin, KCL. It is the direct injection into the sac. It is can be given. But if it fails, there are other radiological methods like uterine artery embolization, embolization of anterior division of internal iliac artery, bilateral internal iliac arteries should be ligated. And always is the before doing this medical managements or conservative treatment, you should always tell the patient that any time she can land into hysterectomy because to save her life, because there will be very much torrential bleeding will be there. Because it will be vascular and there is no uterine serosa or myometrium is there to contract that open vessels. And that is the reason why there is a same with as an abdominal pregnancy, because you all you know in the physiological changes, there will be a dilatation of all the vascular structure. So when there is a baby delivers, the placenta delivers, the uterus gets retract. So this blood there, their living ligatures are there in the uterine cavity and that are absent either in the cervix or in the abdominal cavity, so that these patients will land into the torrential bleeding and there is a life risk to these patients. So the next one we will discuss is Cornwall pregnancy. These are all things. So what is the Cornwall pregnancy? Usually, there will be confusion between the angular pregnancy, Cornwall pregnancy, and interstitial pregnancy. But Cornwall pregnancy is usually the implantation of the gestational sac in the rudimentary horn of the bicornate uterus. Here you can see this is the well-developed uterus, and this is a small horn of the uterus, bicornate uterus, where there is a, you can see this bluish color area. This is a implanted site. So usually it is a non-communicating horn, and always it should be remembered that because this is the uterine anomalies are usually associated with anomalies of genital tracts. So we should always look for this case also. On ultrasound, how we will diagnose that? When on ultrasound, there is visualization of single interstitial portion of the fallopian tube in the main uterine body. You can see this, it is that we can very well visualize the tube. Tube is normal on that side. The gestational sac is separate from the uterus and it is completely surrounded by the myometrium. On the sac, there is a complete myometrium is there on all side of the gestational sac. So it looks like that it is a intrauterine pregnancy only. The vascular pedicle connecting to the gestational sac to the unicornuate uterus. There is a connection between the vascular pedicle and this always we see on the Doppler. The round ligament will be attached, and this is a very important thing where we have to diagnose, differentiate between the corneal and the angular. Here, in this corneal pregnancy, the round ligament will be usually attached laterally to the sac in a case of rudimentary horn. So round ligament is always on the lateral side in case of corneal pregnancy. So we should always differentiate this from, I always say, interstitial pregnancy, painful leiomyoma. When there is a red degeneration of the fibroid, the patient will have excruciating pain like this, painful and degenerated myomas along with the pregnancy. Ovarian tumor with the pregnancy, when there is a torsion and small ovarian tumor, is asymmetrical enlargement of the implantation into the cornu of normal uterus is sometimes. So mainly it is an angular pregnancy. This is lateral. So what do you do? Is treatment is always, what I mean, go for this rudimentary horn should be removed. So hysterectomy, or saying that it is not hysterectomy, is that is this rudimentary horn should be removed is the treatment. Then angular pregnancy. Angular pregnancy is intrauterine implantation in one of the lateral angles of the uterus, and it is medial to the uterotubal junction. It is usually medial to the uterotubal junction and round ligament. So in angular pregnancy, the round ligament, this will be really here in corneal, it will be lateral attachment. And this angular pregnancies can go till term, and there is a risk of abnormal placentation and bleeding. So nowadays, there is one more important ectopic. It's called an ectopic. It's a heterotropic pregnancy. So what do you mean by heterotropic pregnancy? Heterotropic pregnancy is when an ectopic pregnancy, when the pregnancy in any other site is combined with the intrauterine pregnancy. So you can see here, there are two things. This is a uterus, and there is a ongoing intrauterine pregnancy is there. And also, can you see here, there is a yolk sac, there is a fetal pole, all is there in the uterus. This is cervix, and this gestational sac, it is the uterus. And there is small structure which is seen in the adenexa. Here also we can, a small fetal pole like structure is seen. There is a anechoic area is seen. So when there is a intrauterine pregnancy coexist with extrauterine pregnancy, it is called as a heterotropic pregnancy. Previously, the incidence used to be, they used to say that it is around 1 in 30,000. But that was very rare. But due to increased use of ARTs, and this is the main important risk factors, the artificial reproductive techniques, assisted reproductive techniques are the things which are for the heterotropic pregnancy. So the incidence is around in was, so whenever in the case with conceived with ART, always you should have a suspicious that even if you are seeing the intrauterine pregnancy, you should very carefully look for the adenexal masses, anything are there, and you should always keep a watch on this. So incidence in ART cases is around 1%. You should have a high index of suspicions required in cases of female conceived with ART. And the first thing here, the second one is when the patient is having intrauterine pregnancy, the pregnancy is normal, there is no problem, but still the patient is continuously complaining of some vague dragging type of pain into one of the adenexa, or sorry, lateral side of the lower abdomen like that. She's continuously complaining of pain with movements or anything. So here also you should have some suspicion. Then you have done either MTP or termination, DNC, for any miscarriages. But after miscarriages also, the patient is complaining of PV spotting, bleeding, and there is rising of HCG levels. So after miscarriages or after MTP, when there is a rising of HCG levels, you should always have a suspicion of heterotropic pregnancy. When there is a more than one corpus luteum in laparotomy. So already one on the side one, we are seeing one corpus luteum. And when we see, we have done laparotomy with some other children, when we see more than one corpus luteum, that can be also give a diagnosis of heterotropic pregnancy. Here I want to tell you one of the case which I faced. And at this set, one of my friend, she wanted the medical MTP. So always before a medical MTP, we will do ultrasound and we'll see that there is a intrauterine sac. Unless it is confirmed there is an intrauterine pregnancy, we don't go treatment medical MTP. That is, we don't give drugs, mifepristone and mesoprostol. So I did, it was only 5 weeks pregnancy because she has previous 2 LSAs. So 5 weeks pregnancy, there was an intrauterine sac, but that time there was no extrauterine sac was seen. So I gave mifepristone, mesoprostol. She started bleeding, pain, everything is there. Then after 4 or 5 days, suddenly she had excruciating pain in the lower abdomen and with the fainting attacks. Then she went over. She was not here, so she went. She was in Kakinada. She went there to the hospital. They admitted her. Again, they did ultrasound, but there was only minimal free fluid, but still they couldn't find any mass or any sac into the adenexa. So they gave the conservative management, kept her under observation. Again, after 3-4 days, she had severe abdominal pain and fainting attacks. Then that time they did the CT scan, and in that CT scan, they could find there is a small heterotrophic lesion is there in one of the adenexa. And when they opened it, they found that there is a ectopic pregnancy, but it was not actually on the tube, on the ovary. They couldn't exact size of the ectopic pregnancy, but they did laparotomy and they tried salpingo oophorectomy. So usually the management, it depends upon the site. And what we have to do is the ectopic site should be removed, and normally this intrauterine pregnancy will continue. Here we prefer doing laparoscopy. So delay in diagnosis, usually there is a delay in diagnosis in these cases, as because we are seeing the intrauterine pregnancy, we'll be very sure that nothing is going wrong. We will be seeing that this patient is like this only, she is complaining of pain, and there is nothing. So false sense of reassurance in there. The serial monitoring of beta HCG levels are not helpful because there is a concomitant intrauterine pregnancy. As this intrauterine pregnancy is growing, there will be definitely increase in beta HCG levels will be there. So these are the two things where there is a delay in the diagnosis can be there. So treatment is essentially surgical. Do with laparoscopy, prefer, because there is an intrauterine minimal invasive surgery we should follow. There is an intrauterine pregnancy, so less damage, the pregnancy continue, give progesterone support, give rest, and follow the pregnancy carefully. The patients with RH negative should receive anti-D injection, 50 microgram is sufficient for this. Then the next one is interstitial pregnancy. So when there is an implantation in the proximal intramural part of the fallopian tube, it is called as an interstitial pregnancy. The incidence is around 2%. So there is all of you know there are 4 parts of the tube. I already told you. So the part which is inside the uterus is interstitial. So when the pregnancy gets implanted here, the gestational sac develops here, it is interstitial pregnancy. So what are the risk factors? The risk factors are same as of other ectopics, but the additional and specific risk factor for this is usually these interstitial pregnancies are noted when we do ipsilateral salpingectomy. For some, either this is always usually seen when there is a repeat ectopic. For the ectopic, ruptured ectopic, we have done salpingectomy and small portion is remaining there. Here in these cases, the interstitial pregnancies are common. So previous ipsilateral salpingectomy is the main salpingectomy, not salpingos. It is a salpingectomy is the main risk factors. So what is the fate of this? So if we don't diagnose, if it is not diagnosed in ultrasonography, there will be fatal rupture of this. And usually these are diagnosed very less because there is a it is as the one end of the uterus. So there is a space to grow for the growing pregnancy. So these patients usually either in the second trimester, 8 to 16 weeks is the period where these are usually diagnosed when they come to the casualty with shock, intra peritoneal rupture of this ectopic, and there is an intraperitoneal hemorrhage. So when if it is undiagnosed, may rupture between 18 to 16 weeks. It's always catastrophic because there is a rupture and collapse, severe intraperitoneal bleeding is there. So how we will diagnose it? Diagnosis by ultrasonography. So early diagnosis is very important in this. So the uterus is empty. The gestational sac is located in the interstitial or intramural part. It is at the one end of the uterine cornu. We can see the gestational sac, and where this gestational sac is more than 1 centimeter away from the endometrial cavity or endometrial echo. There is a thin, less than 5 mm mantle of myometrial tissue will be seen around. So thin layer of the myometrium can be seen. The most important is interstitial line sign. This is seen on ultrasonography, where we can differentiate this from angular pregnancies, where there is a thin echogenic line is seen extending from the uterine cavity to the periphery of the sac. On ultrasonography, we can see the thin echogenic line, which is seen from the endometrial, extending from the endometrial cavity, going till the sac. Periphery of the sac, and it represents the interstitial part of the fallopian tube. This is very highly sensitive and specific marker to diagnose interstitial pregnancies. If you missed here, the importance is 3D ultrasound rather than on 2D ultrasound. The 3D ultrasound is more helpful for diagnosis of this. MRI also will be helpful to differentiate from other ectopics. So what is the management? Management is, if it is early unruptured ectopic, we can give local or intramuscular methotrexate and follow. But mostly it is by surgical treatment. So laparoscopy or laparotomy, where we can see the enlarged protuberance lying outside the round ligament, distal fallopian tubes and ovaries. So we can do corneal resection or open the cornu, remove the, suck out the ectopic and control the hemorrhage there. But this is also here because there is ovarian and uterine artery anastomosis is there. So this site is also can bleed heavily. So control of hemorrhage is also very important. So main important thing is here, we should be always keep the blood ready. The one more thing is we can do corneal resection in this case. High risk of, we have to follow these patients very carefully because these patients, if we do the conservative management, only do corneal resection, corneotomy, and this patient next time get pregnant, there is chances of uterine rupture. So elective cesarean sections are required for this cases. If there is a rupture of the interstitial pregnancy, definitely you have to go for hysterectomy, keeping the blood ready. And nowadays it is increasing. As all of you know that there is a increased rate of cesarean sections. So almost previously it used to be around 15%, but nowadays it is around more than 40%. And this is also one of the, you can say that side effect or a consequence of increased rates of cesarean section. So cesarean sections ectopic is STP. It is cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy. So scar ectopic pregnancy is recently reported. What is the definition of this cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy? This cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy is also called as like isthmocele, and it can be diagnosed during pregnancy or in the non-pregnant also. So implantation into the myometrial defect, this gestational sac, it is implanted into the myometrial defect occurring at the site of previous uterine incision. Where we have given the incision on the lower segment, but because it was not upper and lower segment are only formed during pregnancy, this one at the end of third trimester. But after that, the uterus become one. So when there is a small myometrial defect at the level of the uterine incision, previous incision, and this sac gets implanted there. This is called as a scar ectopy. Nowadays, the prevalence is around 1 in 2000. So what is the fate of this ectopic, cesarean ectopic? Usually, maybe ongoing viable, or it can be with signs and symptoms of miscarriage, failing pregnancies. Mainly, it is misdiagnosed as intrauterine or cervical pregnancies. So this is the thing. The clinical features are usually similar to threatened and inevitable abortion. Here, these are missed for intrauterine pregnancy, where the sag is low-lying, that we can say that, or in the cesarean ectopics. So there are two different types of cesarean scar ectopic pregnancies. The first one, it progresses into the uterine cavity. So what, there are two types. What happens to this? What is the fate of the cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy? The first one, it will go into the intrauterine cavity and has the potential to reach to the viability. But with the risk, when it reaches to the viability, this one, and when we do for repeat cesarean section, there are chances of torrential hemorrhage, because the height of lodgement is at the level of previous cesarean section. Implantation site is less. The bleeding can be massive from the implantation site. The second one is, it can progress toward the serosal surface of the uterus. First one, it will grow inside the uterine cavity and become the intrauterine pregnancy. The second one, it will go towards the serosal surface of the uterus, and with the risk of first trimester rupture. And it, when it comes to the serosal surface, there is no this one, it will rupture. So first trimester rupture and hemorrhage. So a cesarean section scar defect or isthmocele, or this is the thing which predisposed to the scar ectopics. This is all predisposing factors for scar ectopics. So how we will diagnose this? The scar, cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy is diagnosed when there is a uterine cavity is empty. Usually the clinical features are same for threatened as threatened and inevitable abortion, severe pain with bleeding, venting attacks. The empty endocervical canal, there is a uterine cavity is also empty, cervical canal is also empty. The gestational sac or trophoblastic mass is located at the level of the internal os, and it is embedded in the site of previous scar. So this can be diagnosed in ultrasound. Mainly it was 3D, 4D ultrasound. There is a thin or absent layer of myometrium between the gestational sac blood. When it comes to the serosal surface, there is no this one myometrial levels. There is evidence of prominent trophoblastic, and this is more important here, Doppler imaging. When we see there is a prominent trophoblastic or placental circulation on the Doppler, when we see that there is a excessive vascularity is there, when we put the Doppler, this is diagnosed excessive vascularity of the gestational sac around the level can be diagnosis of cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy. This is why I always tell you, always we should have a suspicion, always think ectopic, then we can diagnose ectopic. So always ectopic should be there in the back of our mind. So what is the treatment of this ectopic? If you mentioned, we can you go for methotrexate injection, medical management, either locally or intramuscularly. But the most importantly, the treatment is surgical treatment. It is preferred either through laparoscopy or through open methods laparotomy, and can be done. And this is the part of the ectopic is removed and it can be repaired. So rarely it requires, when there is a torrential bleeding, to control that bleeding, hysterectomy is required. But if it is a multiparous woman, she has completed her family, then to avoid the risk to this one, to go for hysterectomy. So in young patient, I always told you resection and suturing of the scar can be done. But here also there is a high risk of, and then patient gets pregnant next time, there is a high risk of rupture of the scar. Methotrexate under ultrasound guidance in the directly into the sac, we can do. So other rare types are, there can be multiple ectopics, pregnancy after hysterectomy, primary splaining pregnancy, primary hepatic, retroperitoneal, diaphragmatic. These are very, 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 very rare. And Julie, I have not seen any case of this till my this one. So, but why this is very important ectopic is because the mortality is around 10 to 15% if it is, and it is mainly due to the hemorrhage if it is not diagnosed properly. So here we are going to finish the ectopic completely. I know you have already done with this. So there are few questions which you need to take on this. So these are the few questions which are usually asked on this topic. So what are the sites? So there are small question, there can be short notes, and there is a long. Already I told you two. So what are the sites of ectopic pregnancy? What are the clinical features of ruptured ectopic pregnancy? How you can diagnose unruptured ectopic pregnancy? What are the indications for medical management of ectopic pregnancy? What is the ultrasound finding? Is 100% diagnosis of, these are the small MCQs where you can have a, what is the ultrasound finding that is 100% diagnostic of unruptured ectopic? What are the features, clinical features of ovarian pregnancy? What is tubal abortion? What are the investigations you will do for a patient with suspected ectopic pregnancy? How you will diagnose hemoperitoneum? Why is it important to determine the RH factor in woman with ectopic pregnancy? And what you will do with the patient with RH negative? What are the reasons for increased incidence of ectopic pregnancy? Why does choledocentesis does not have choledocentesis? You know what is choledocentesis? When we puncture in the through the posterior pouch of Douglas, and there is a blood is removed which is non-clotting. This is previously they used to use for diagnosis. Nowadays we are not using. What is ring of fire pattern? What is PUL? PUL is pregnancy of unknown origin. What are spinal bar criteria? What are the surgical options to manage ectopic pregnancy? How often you will determine beta HCG levels during expectant management with methotrexate? What is the first immediate management in woman with ruptured ectopic pregnancy in shock? How you will manage patient in shock? What when ultrasound is suggestive of fluid in Morrison's pouch in ruptured ectopic pregnancy, what do you interpret? What history you will elicit in woman with suspected ectopic pregnancy? These are the small questions which are there on ectopic pregnancy. I hope all of you have understood. If you have any queries, kindly let me know. Thank you. ఏం చాట్ బాక్స్ ఏం కనబడట్లేదు కుమార్ నాకు చాట్ బాక్స్ కనబడట్లేదు ఏం లేదా If the patient having active cirrhosis, then what is for ectopic pregnancies, methotrexate is contraindicated. You can go for surgery when there is methotrexate is contraindicated. There is no other option. You have to go for surgery. Either you can do laparoscopy or laparotomy. So first thing you have to rule out the contraindication for methotrexate. Whenever you are doing medical management, all the contraindications to, that's what we do LFT before starting of methotrexate, and we repeat after 3 days also, even if we are giving single dose. For multi dose, it is compulsory that we should do LFT, RFT, and so. Why hysteroscopy is not recommended in ectopic? From which ectopic will we use hysteroscopy? Hysteroscopy is we put a scope into the uterus. Here they are saying that and for cervical pregnancy we can, but there is a chance of very torrential bleeding. So better to go for medical management for the thing. We don't use hysteroscopy there, ectopic. Then again, angular interstitial pregnancy. Okay. So interstitial pregnancy is the ectopic sac is lodged into the interstitial part of the fallopian tube. So it is very rare a thing of a tubal ectopic only. And in angular pregnancy, it is the lateral angle of the uterus where we can see the myometrium. Myometrial layer will be there. Here in the interstitial, there will not be any myometrial layer which can be seen. Or even if it is there, it is very, very thin. Each and every case of ectopic, we should not go for expectant management. Unruptured tubal pregnancy, expectant management. There are criteria to follow the expectant management where the patient, the first and foremost important thing here, it is that here the patient's education is very important. She is able to follow what you are telling. The patient should come for compliance is very important. She should be carefully following with you. Here, because we are just, and here there is no, the ectopic sac size is less than 1.5 to 2 centimeter. The beta HCG levels are less than 1,000. Then the patient is hemodynamically stable. She is residing very near to you where she can come to the hospital and follow. So you, not all the cases we do. Here it is very early ectopics. We can go for expectant management. Unruptured tubal ectopic pregnancies can go for medical management also. Not necessary that only done for this. If it is ruptured pregnancy, how we will do expectant management? There is already blood in this. Patient is already having tachycardia and hypotension. How can we go for expectant management? We can't go for expectant management there because it is already ruptured. So when it is unruptured, either you can go for all these modalities are there for unruptured. Expectant, medical, and laparoscopy. Misoprostol lead to abortions. This mifepristone and misoprostol we use for the medical MTP. I think MTP lecture is finished with you. So you only should tell me how it is misoprostol lead to abortions. Misoprostol doesn't lead to, mifepristone is the drug which kills the pregnancy and misoprostol will only evacuate the pregnancy. So to throw out the pregnancy, to expel misoprostol is used. Am I clear? So now before lecture also you should read. After lecture also you should read and do the question and answers and write it because ectopic pregnancy is very important for you. For you, for exam purpose and for the practical purpose. Okay, thank you. I hope no more questions are there.